Today we got a wonderful couple with us. They are the giant killers, and we are going to see from them amazing story of their life. They have been active members in Couples of Christ, so their ministry is all about couples. So they work as couples, and they have got amazing victories in their life. So welcome, Brother Vincent and Melanie.
Hello, good brother. Praise Jesus.
Oh, you have kept the mic and everything ready, man.
One mic for two people. Aisa jayega.
Praise God. Praise so that's Melanie and that's Vincent. They were in Bahrain. All those who have been in Bahrain, you would have seen the priest less in the church and Vincent more in the church. So all the time, you would have seen Vincent in every what do you call, like Jude. In every department, Vincent has been there. Praise God. So, where do we start? Tell us.
Brother, you ask the question, we'll answer.
No, at least you give me some start. I'll start with Melanie. So, okay, Melanie, where do we start? Tell us about how did you encounter the Lord and how did the Couples of Christ started or something like this. Then we can go from there.
Actually, we were blessed that 1 year after we got married in 95. We're going to complete 25 years tomorrow. So 1 year after we got married, we heard an announcement in the church and we joined the Couples for Christ. In fact, there was a series of teachings and that's how our renewal started. So it was a good thing actually, because it was a wonderful thing that we were able to join the renewal. One thing being that we had a courtship of only around 6 months. Yeah, around 6 months. So we didn't really know one another so well. So in the first year that we got married, there were a lot of misunderstandings, a lot of communication problems, but praise God, because we got into the renewal, we understood what it was to live, a godly life as husband and wife. And that's how our walk with the Lord started. It was more on a prayer and a community life. There was not much of the word of God. We used to read the Bible, but never with that understanding, never knowing what we were reading, never able to, in fact, we used to just do it as a spiritual exercise because, we had to complete our quota of reading the Bible. But there was never that understanding of the word until we came for a retreat. I think it was in 2008.
Okay. Now, what about Brother Vincent? How was your encounter with Jesus? When did you get into the revival?
See, brother, when we
married, after marriage, 1 year, you got the first taste. When did you get the taste?
After we got married, I was a Sunday Christian. I used to go to mass. I used to come back. That was my good.
But you were not an active person like you were in Bahrain?
No. Before I got married and even after I got married, I was an outstanding member.
Really?
Yeah, yes, I was outstanding. I mean, for me, Sunday mass was enough for me. That was good enough for me.
To see you all that, I thought you would have been from the altar boy from that time, all the titles.
No. I was not even an altar boy.
You are surprising me today.
Yeah, I was not even an altar boy.
Okay, then that 1 year after the marriage, you all both went.
So my wife's heard one announcement. Melanie heard the announcement in the church saying there is a meeting of couples.
And you were in the same church.
Same church in Bahrain. She heard the announcement.
But you did not hear.
No, I did not hear.
So that means I know what you are doing on Sunday mass. Coming only for attendance, but not attentive.
Why we are all matching always together in that respect? Because we used to go to Sunday mass only for that. I used to always iron my shirt and pant and see that I was tip-top when I used to go to mass.
Okay, and we used to be in the balcony, brother.
And we used to be in the balcony.
Because there was like the multi-purpose hall had down and then the balcony. So on the balcony, you could get a good view.
I've been to that.
Right.
So tell me, how did you encounter?
So when we joined the Couples for Christ, there was a series of talks that was about 12 talks. And after we joined, there was some change. Definitely there was some change, because at least now we were in community. We used to meet every week. And then we used to have talks. We used to have teachings. We used to have fellowship. So apart from going to the club and going to other things, slowly, gradually, we got ourselves into a spiritual activity, unlike going for any other thing. So gradually, over a time, maybe almost about 5 to 6 years, we really found ourselves, fellowshipping with people who were more of church goers than non-church goers.
So that was a great advantage for you, that the children also would be in fellowship with other children also.
Right.
Also in the same atmosphere.
Right. Yes. Right.
So the children were excited to come for the meeting because they would meet other children and there would be great fellowship.
Well, the children were not even born, brother, when we joined the Couples for Christ. They were born after about...
5 years, no, Ray Baba.
So...
You are giving me mathematics. You said 1 year and 5 years. 6 years, you did not have children?
No.
We got married in 95. Our eldest was born in 98. We joined Couples for Christ in 96. So by the time it was about 4 or 5 years, the children were still very small. They were very small.
Okay.
We had in 4 years, we had with three of them.
Then what happened after that?
Then after that, it was more of, community teachings. But really, the word of God was never alive to us. It was more like, reading the word, more because of our requirement of Couples of Christ. There's 15 minutes of scripture reading, and being together as community, sharing the gospel as we thought it was. It was never based on the truth. It was based on what I thought. So we used to share, each of us used to share what I thought about the gospel, never knew the truth really. But eventually, there was not really, a buildup of our faith. Faith wasn't there. It was more of, pray. It was more of, spiritual exercises, lot of meetings, prayer meetings every week. We had people below us whom we used to lead. But really, there was not much of faith. It was not really faith. It was more of, spirituality. I would say it was more of spirituality, not really faith.
So what was your experience, Melanie?
Yeah, for me, it made a big difference, brother, because I was, handling 3 children on my own at that. We didn't have any family out there. So I used to look forward to go to the meetings because I would be able to fellowship with other people of faith. And the kids also would interact with people, other kids. So it made a big, it made a difference in a way, because community life was good. And we were enjoying our life over there. God had. There was another thing I wanted to. I would like to share, brothers, because I was working initially for about 3 years, and then when I was expecting our first child, actually the Lord spoke to me, and I decided to quit my job because the job was very strenuous and I had to spend long hours at work. So I clearly got a message from the Lord in the word of God, saying that do not store up treasures for yourself where moths and rust destroy, but store up treasures for yourself in heaven. And that's when I decided, and we both mutually agreed that I would quit my work and look after the kids and be at home and look after the kids. And I think it was a wonderful decision, because today if we look at our children, it's only because, I made that sacrifice to
the investment.
Yeah, the investment rather that.
That's a powerful investment to quit the job and stay back.
Yeah, praise God for that. Praise God. And God was the one who gave me all that, the strength and the peace. And of course, with Vincent's support. And in spite of, having, that time Vincent had just a small job, having, only one salary, God promoted him. In such a way that every time a child was born, he got a promotion at his work. And
so why did you have only 3 then? every child he was getting promotion.
Brother, we were not in America, UK. We were in Bahrain, brother. There is only one level of promotion. You can't go beyond that.
Okay.
So praise God, all our needs were met.
Melanie, you know me, right?
Yes, brother.
I keep traveling in between, okay?
Yeah. No problem.
Okay, then.
So then you say what?
No, continue. I know his story. I want to know your story.
Yeah, so that was our life, brother, because, the children started going to school and, you know, it was a very comfortable and a very, very cozy life out there. We had everything found, nothing missing in our life. But I think deep down, there was something amiss, you know. I always had that...
That emptiness.
Emptiness. There was some kind of, I thought I could relate to God. I used to relate to God on an emotional level most of the time, because whenever there was a praise and worship and all, I used to always cry. And I thought, you know, that's how you relate to God, that you have to feel something, you know, you have to feel goosebumps, or you have to feel, you have to have that kind of emotional experience.
You ever had a goosebump?
Yes, brother. Yeah, many times.
So many times. So you were sure now the prayers are answered.
Yeah. And then there was another thing. We thought that, you know, whenever we were blessed, or whenever that there was something, some blessing on our way, we thought it was like, you know, because we were in community, because we were going to church, or because, you know, we were serving. Yeah, by that time, Vincent was serving in almost every ministry in the church. He was in the lectors.
There were no new ministries waiting. and others, in all the ministries, every ministry, you say, the Legion of Mary, Anthony, Paul, Peter, James, John, all the ministries, he was there.
Yes.
Those are new ministries I heard today, brother. Anyway.
Yeah, whatever ministries, and he was he was always ready for service.
It was his heart.
Yeah,
that God has given me this life, and I want to give God back, and that's why, you know, his intention was not the leadership, but his intention was, how can I serve God with whatever, because the person's capacity is big, and you put him in one department. Now, when his capacity is big, he is looking into the other department and saying, can I come because I've got plenty of time, can I come and help you? So said, come. So he went, goes and helps there. Now he found that in spite of helping everybody there, he still got more energy left. What do you say, Vincent?
Not really, brother. I mean, the intention was that, you know, wherever I'm called, I would serve. And the important thing was, in that service, I would always think that if the Lord can use me in that, I will do it.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah. But at the same time, although I wanted the Lord to use me, there was so much of self in that. There was so much of self. It was really not... See, I'll be honest. At that time, although I was serving in different capacities in the church, there was a lot of self involved, because I'm doing it.
Like Jude.
Yeah. It's more about me.
You heard Jude?
Yeah, Papa, I'm listening.
No. But did you hear Jude's testimony, brother?
No, I've not heard Jude's testimony.
Jude was from the altar boy. He was the leader in altar boy. He was leader in everything. He was a president in everything. He was a president of everything.
So he was.
And if the priest had to forget to put his name there for Thanksgiving, then he would go and fight with the priest also. Because he had all the titles.
Praise God.
So when you're saying self, I can understand better after listening to Jude's testimony.
Right. But in my case, there was a lot of self, I would say. Yes, I'm doing serving the Lord, but the self was there in the sense that, you know, it's not that I wanted to be acknowledged that, you know, definitely not that. But the self means I'm doing it. I'm also doing it. I'm doing my part. So it was always a lot of self in that.
So when did everything start changing?
Everything started changing when I first time heard your CD. Not I never saw you, I never met you, but I got your CD of the sower and the seed. in 2008, December 2008. And when I got that CD, because you had visited Bahrain that time, in some hotel you had visited, and somebody
was the best preaching in Bahrain. People were under the table.
Yes, that's right. That's right.
Can you believe in Bahrain people go under the table?
Praise
when the
God.
Preaching started, they went down under the table, and it was in a hotel.
Yes. I think Brother Prashant and you had both come to one hotel.
Yes, yes, yes.
And Arlene and Oliver, who are now in the UK, whom I met in Bristol about six months ago, they had actually come to your meeting, and they gave me the CD. So I made a copy and I began to listen to that CD. And as I began to listen to the word, this is the first time I heard the word being explained in such a simple way. It was made so easy to understand. It was even a little child, even a little baby could understand that, you know. And all the things that I've been hearing, the theology and the philosophy and the, forget about what, I mean, every logy, whatever was there, it was all broken down to a simple, you know, understandable language. And that basically began to attract me to the word.
So how long would you be listening to the CD?
How long? Oh, my wife is here. They used to call me for lunch and dinner, and I'm hearing the plugs on me with me. And they are calling me and they're saying, what's happened to this guy? I went to the office. I'm in the car. Yeah. And it was like for the next 1 month, it was like virtually I was asleep with the headphones for that 1 month.
So what was going on in your mind, Melanie?
No, I was just wondering what was so wonderful in the CD. So on and off, like when he has put it in the house, I would come and listen. I think the first one talk I heard was Angelina's testimony. And there was something, you know, something very different. I would say very different that I was hearing in the CD. But honestly, brother, I never took it seriously. I think it was a hardness of my side. That you know, I was not open to it, I did not seriously take it as much as Vincent was, you know, asking us to, you know, listen to it, and he was even asking the kids, come on, let's hear what's on the CD. But none of us took him seriously, because we were all involved in our own lives, and you know, with community and with so many other things, in the, you know, the children, dropping them, picking them up. And by then I had just started a small part-time job. So we were I was so involved in my own life that you know, I didn't pay attention to what he was telling me.
And while listening to the CD, he must have changed from east to west.
I wouldn't say the changes came suddenly, but it came gradually, brother. Definitely over a period of time, there was so much more than that. You know, he used to tell us so many things that it was very difficult for us to understand, in the sense that they were so anti or so whatever we had been hearing all along. So there were so many things new to us,
and it was challenging to break down all those things.
Yeah, it was very challenging. And I think it was in 2008 that December when we came to Goa, he gave you a call, and then you called him, brother. He had sent you an email, and you called him at my mom's place. And he was so excited. He said, you know, Brother Johnson called me. We all have to go for this retreat. And he, like, you know, he literally dragged us all to go for the retreat. So the whole family came for that retreat. I think it was at Emerald Lawns.
Yeah, it was in Emerald Lawns.
Yeah.
I remember that.
And that was our first encounter, and my first encounter with you and with the word really expounded so beautifully.
I think on that day, there were a lot of signs and wonders.
Yes, there were signs.
Was there on that day that baby who had no saliva gland, the saliva gland was created? Were you on that day?
No, I can't remember, brother, that. Yeah. Okay. I clearly remember there were people who were in wheelchair. They started, one person started walking. So
That's why I'm saying.
Yeah.
There were these foreigners on that day. Were you there on that day?
Foreigners? I can't remember, brother. I don't
know. Because this girl was born without a saliva gland.
Okay.
So she doesn't have saliva. So she cannot swallow the food. Okay. I should search for that video. And I said, you know what? my God can create new organs in no time. And I was so excited. And the girl's father used to be a hippie. So he had come to Goa during the hippie days. And now he has come to Goa, a born again Christian. So the cab man got him over there. I think it was Anthony who got him there. And he said, you just come for half an hour and everything will be all right. And that's when we were speaking our faith. And the baby, you should see her, her mouth is so much full of saliva that it comes out of her lips, the saliva dripping down. The girl who had no saliva gland by birth, getting brand new saliva glands and the saliva coming out of her lips. We'll search for that video. We'll put it during the lunch break or somewhere. So, praise God. Then what happened?
And then, of course, brother, after I came for that retreat, it was December. And then I remember after that retreat, we would be in touch with you because we wanted you to come to Bahrain. And that was the time in 2010, Father Dinesh became the parish priest and he wanted to have in sometime in November, like Advent, he wanted to have a mission. And since by then I was already in the parish pastoral council, I put forward the proposal and Father Dinesh allowed that for you to be coming there. And that was the first time in 2010.
That was amazing.
That was amazing. That was amazing. We had such a huge crowd and the
balcony, everything full.
Yeah, we had such an amazing sign.
I can never forget the last day. The time was up and Father Dinesh told me, you can take a collection. So the first day he said, no collection. And then he said, because I remember that evening we went to meet him before the meeting could start. And he said, I want you to take a collection. And I said, Father, if you take a collection, I will lose my 15 minutes. So can you give me that 15 minutes extra? Okay. So he said, no, you can take a collection and you can preach. I said, no way. When the preaching is going on, nobody does any other activity. So he gave us the 15 minutes extra. And in that 15 minutes extra, I was teaching on faith. And I said, all those who have got lumps, please come out. You remember that?
Yes. I was there on stage with you.
Yeah, I know. So do you remember that?
Yes.
Yes. So there were about 12 or 13 of them. And I remember one lady, I was asking them, how many lumps you got? How many? This lady said, I don't know. And I said, what do you mean, I don't know? She said, my whole body is full of lumps. Now, as Jesus said, which one is easy? To say to that paralytic man, to get up from the bed. And Jesus said, or to say, your sins are forgiven. So to make you understand, Jesus opened his mouth and told that man, rise up and walk. You remember? So I said, which one is easy for my God? To take one lump out or all the lumps out? So for you to understand what my God can do, let's start with the lady with plenty of lumps. And as I put my hand, she began to manifest. She began to roll. And by the time she finished all that and she stood up, I said, how many lumps you got? She touched her sleeves and she said, everything is gone. The moment she said, everything is gone, the others, I did not even have to pray. They fell down like a pack of cards and everybody got healed. Now I know that I have to go to the airport and everybody is going to stop me now. Because the 2 days they had stopped after the meeting. Everybody wants to be prayed over. And I said, Lord, now what do I do? He said, worship. So I called the choir and I said, let's worship. And they all closed their eyes. And I said, Brother Vincent, let's run.
I remember that.
But everybody's eyes were closed. Brother Vincent and I'm running through the crowd. Out. Did not meet Father Dinesh and him. And we did reach on time. Just running to take my boarding pass. And there I was panting with the boarding pass. And I showed you, hey, brother, I got my boarding pass. And there I was on my flight to Kuwait. God bless you, brother.
And of course, you did not share about what happened at Kuwait.
When father told me to take a collection, and I said, no, I don't want to take a collection. I lose my 15 minutes. When I landed in Kuwait, a man got a dream that morning, telling the Lord, telling him to give me a check of 10 lakhs. Okay. And he came in the evening and he said, God spoke to me and said, give you a check of 10 lakhs. I'm so sure. Now that 10 lakhs check was not for me, for the new creation home. But what I want to tell you is, even if I would have taken a collection, I wouldn't have got 10 lakhs.
No.
So when you trust God, God doesn't need 1,000 people to come and bless you. He can send just one person and pay off your bills.
Praise God.
So I've seen amazing things happening by operating in faith. And that's what I said, faith takes you into the supernatural.
Praise God.
Yeah, tell me after that what happened.
Then after that, those
days were so beautiful, man.
Praise God.
But now it is more beautiful because you have started your own branches and you are preaching somewhere. I'm preaching somewhere. And that's a dream that everybody, and today when you have come here, I am believing for more doors to open, more countries to open, and God doing more things in your life. Yes, tell us more now.
Praise God. And then, of course, brother, after that, you were coming every month to Bahrain. We used to have such a wonderful time because after that, with all the persecution that started after that, you know how it was. No coming to church and no coming inside and all the issues. We began to have our regular monthly meeting in the hotel. We started meeting in the hotel. And then, of course, even though in the hotel, people started coming in such large numbers, and then of course that also was stopped, and then eventually we decided to have it in my home every month, and we had it for I think almost about 3 years. We went right up to 2013 or 2000, early 2014.
I wanted to share also by this time, we had slowly the family, the whole family, slowly had
the taste
of the word. Because we started seeing it become so alive. For example, whenever one of the kids would fall sick, the first thing before rushing them to the doctor, initially, when the kids were young, our first response was always to rush them to the doctor and panic. As a mom, I would panic. But now the first thing would, we would pray over them and we would rebuke the sickness, because that is what we learned. And we started seeing, in the first those years, I remember the kids we would never reach to a stage that we had to take them to the doctor.
Whenever you're saying the word kid, something is happening to me. I said I'll not stop, but now it's taking me more and more troubling, because a kid is a young one of a sheep.
Okay, the children, sorry, but
because what you call, and a sheep is a animal who will always lose its way.
Okay.
So please, this is what I was calling my children. And after that, I never ever called them by the word kid. The Lord said, don't call my children kid. He did not say, don't call your children. He said, don't call my children kid. They are my children. So from
praise, praise God, praise God.
That was not heard from any preaching. That came to me directly. And when God gave me directly, from that day, I've never called my children kid.
Praise Jesus.
Yeah.
So the children also started, learning the word. In fact, all of the whole family, we had by then we had by-hearted all the three scriptures concerning worry and fear, concerning material needs, and concerning wisdom and guidance. Yeah. So even the
comfort
and strength. Yeah. That was a bit difficult for the children because it was a very long one. No? So the youngest was at that time, he was, I think, 4 years old. But he knew the first three. And every day we would confess. We would take turns to confess. And we would confess the word. And there were so many other scriptures also from the white book that we planted in our hearts. And the children also planted it in their hearts. So that's how we started, seeing the word. But more importantly, we saw the word come alive in different situations of our life, whether it was in at Vincent's workplace or at my workplace, and in our own life. And okay, we can check.
Yeah, so that I used to give the children at that age, you know, they always used to learn nursery rhymes in school very young. But I used to give them incentives. I'll give you a dinar if you learn the
point. I remember the house.
Yeah, that of course came.
How many points did you get?
That game next stage.
That was the points for doing the household chores, brother.
They used to get points for doing the household chores. So somebody would do the house cleaning. Somebody would do the dishes, of course. And you know, by then they all wanted to have incentive. But the real incentive that they had, which started off, was by studying these four verses concerning
wisdom. And the ones who study, he gets a dinner.
Yes.
And it is amazing that even though our youngest, our son was about, I think at that time, he was in 2009, he was 5 years old, or 6 years old. And our eldest was about, all three of them, within about a week's time, they had learned concerning wisdom and guidance, fear and worry, and material needs. All three within 1 week. And so Melanie had not by hearted that time.
Comfort and
So when she saw the children pick it up, she said that, well, I also must do it. If they can do it, I also. So everybody, and then of course, by the end of 2 weeks, the whole family would confess all these scriptures every day during our family time. All the scriptures, just the scriptures. Before we used to pray, you know, a lot of flesh prayers, Lord bless us and do this to us, you know. But now we were just praying the spirit, just praying the word.
Now, when faith is increasing, the Bible says, consider it nothing but joy when you encounter trials of any kind, because the testing of your faith produces patience. And when patience has its perfect work in you, you shall mature, get developed, become excellent, lacking in nothing. So now the family is building up faith, spiritual muscles are growing. Had the devil gone into some vacation?
But you know, brother, although this was happening in our home, the children were learning the word, we were all confessing the word. Personally, I'm going to share this about myself personally. Personally, I was going through a very ding-dong battle. I was going through a ding-dong battle in my mind, because I know the word. I've picked up the way the word should work. I go back to what I normally do at church, and I hear something else. Now I've got the word. So there is a total battle going on in my mind. And this went on for almost 4 to 5 years. So between 2012 to 2014, till about this battle was going on in my mind between, you know, the word, between the truth, and between philosophy. You know what I'm saying? What was actually happening. So there was so much, and as a result, there used to be swings in the way I used to act. So there used to be faith sometimes, there used to be unbelief sometimes, there was a battle going on in my mind for that time. And it was during this time, sometime in 2014, that it started off in 2013. In 2013, my mom passed away. In 2013, Melanie's dad passed away. And in 2013, another family member, my other brother-in-law's father, passed away. And that was in matter of 4 months, we had three very close members of our family who passed away. My mom, Melanie's mom, and dad, and my brother-in-law's father. So it was like...
Melanie's dad, right?
Yes.
You said Melanie's mom by mistake.
Dad.
Yeah.
My mom passed away in June. Dad passed away in October. And my brother-in-law's father was hit by a car in November. So it was like June, July, August. In about 4 months, we had three very close family members. So that was a real big jolt for us as a family. And again, at this point in time, I was going through my own battle between the truth and between, you know, the pendulum swing, so whatever. And so it was really a hard personal time for me personally. I mean, I'm talking about myself personally. So if somebody had to probably ask me about the word, I was not so convincing. I was not so convinced myself, because here is three major deaths in the family. I've got the word of God, but at the same time, there's so much happening around me. And that's the time the enemy struck. The enemy struck because I was accused at my workplace. I was working in the government. I was working in a very senior position, and I was accused sometime around September of 2014, just about a year after all this happened. And when that happened, I just went into a total depression. And that was the time I literally thought that, what is this? Where is God? I mean, this is like a situation of hopelessness. Literally, I had such fear within me. I literally did not even understand whether I was really living or not. You know, when you talk about life, the word which you use, life is the sum total of your thoughts, your emotions, your words, your dreams, your desires. At that point in time, for me, my life just crumbled. It was just like, what? Every moment is like a long wait. It's like an unending moment. And I remember literally dragging myself to work every day, because I was not given any work, but I reached a point where I just couldn't even get out of my house. That's the time in December, Melanie actually accompanied me to Goa for the retreat. And then of course, we spent 2 weeks in Bangalore. It was December of 2014. During this 2 weeks of 2014, you know very well, it was just like we were fed with the word, but I was still not out of it. I was still, I would say, if on a scale of 1 to 10, I would say two or three points, I was better off. 7, I was still out. I was not in the right state of mind. And I was not even prepared to go back to Bahrain. You remember how many attempts were made to get me back to Bahrain. I was just having fear to even go back to Bahrain. And then literally there was a battle between my family and me. And then I don't know, somehow through friends and through every mode, I actually caught that flight and reached into Bahrain.
Did you say how two flights he refused to board and two flight tickets were gone? The third flight also, nearly halfway it was gone. And this time it was not a direct flight. This time it was via Bombay.
This time it was via Bombay, yes. But it was always via Bombay.
In those 15 days that we spent together at my place, okay, I know every detail of it still in my mind. And it really helps me to minister to another person with depression.
I mean, what happened to me then between September, when I was accused, to almost a year and a half after I was still in Bahrain, what I went through that stage is something that the Lord taught me. Now, when I look at it from this side now, when I look at, you know, it's like looking at it on the other side of the resurrection. For me, when I look at what happened then and how much the Lord has through his word got me out, it helps me now to immediately understand what a depression patient is going. Even by the time they start talking, they start saying, like, for example, last night, I had somebody from Malaysia call me and tell me that I am going through this palpitation. I'm going through this sleepless night. I'm going through this weakness. I'm going through this drowsiness. And as soon as the person just spoke to me for 3 minutes, I said to the person, stop. I know exactly what you are. And I said, you must have gone to the doctor and the doctor told you that there's nothing wrong with you. She said, yes. Doctor says nothing is wrong with me. And I said immediately to her, I'm going to give you the formula which got me out. Now you don't need to go through the hard way. The recipe is ready. Here's the recipe. So when I had gone through that whole situation of depression, now it was easy to reach out to somebody. And brother, you know, when I look at it now on the other side, I don't know how many people have actually either called because of the testimony that I shared on the Viper. Remember the Viper testimony? Because when I went back to Bahrain,
just tell that because it's going to help someone.
You sent the teaching on the Viper, and you said in that teaching, because for me that Viper testimony or that Viper teaching became like for me the catalyst for my healing. That Viper testimony, that Viper teaching. And in that Viper teaching, I remember you had shared, just like it is written in the book of Corinthians, that the word of God is like a net that traps every thought that exalts itself over the word of God.
2 Corinthians 10:5.
So what I did was, when I would get those negative thoughts, I would open my mouth and speak only one scripture. Because for me, I realized that if I can't remember anything and I can't pray, the love of God, the unconditional love of God, will never fail. And so for me, John 17:26, the love the Abba Father had for Jesus, he has the same love for us. There's no difference. When we believe in Jesus, the same love the Heavenly Father has for his son Jesus is the same love that he has for each one of us when we believe in Jesus. So I began to confess this scripture every time. Thank you, Abba Father, for filling me with the love of Jesus. Thank you, Abba Father, for filling. So whenever I used to get those negative thoughts, I used to open my mouth, and without even, you know, at that point in time, I could never understand. Because when those negative thoughts would come, the only way was to open my mouth and speak. And until that teaching came for a couple of months, my thought would be like, I would start with something so small, and within minutes, I was like broken completely, because one thought after the other to the other would take me probably to some place where I was literally in hell. But the moment that teaching came on, thank you, Abba Father, for filling me with the love of Jesus, that's the time I began to realize that as I open my mouth and speak that word continually, even though at that point in time, those thoughts were still coming in, over a period of time, in fact, it began to like, it was be sometimes 30 minutes, 40 minutes. But as I began to use that word, open my mouth and speak, I began to realize the duration of which these thoughts used to come to me slowly over a period of time of 5 to 6 months began to progressively reduce. And that is where I found that I could get out of depression, and eventually I could have a clarity of mind. And the moment the mind was clear, now I could read the word, now I could pray, now I could do what I had to do. Now there was that confidence to go and reach out to somebody. Now there was the confidence to go back to my car and bring the children from the school. And by the time 5 to 6 months had passed, I could even go out of my house because I had fear to even drive the car. Melanie used to drive the car. And then I went out of the house, and that was a time I met somebody who told me, what are you doing? And he offered me a job. And because I got this job after almost, literally I was working between September to almost 10 months, because for 10 months I wasn't working. So I was literally rusty. I was rusty. And so when I got that job, it lasted only for about 2 weeks, because in 2 weeks time, when I went to the workplace, the people who had actually hired me for the job knew what I could do, because I was working in the government before. I had a different type of job, but now I still couldn't, you know, adjust myself to the job. In 2 weeks time, they fired me. They said, we don't need your services. So I was back to square one. But praise God, within 3 days, I got another job, and that job I worked on for another 2 years. So I would drive, I would go about it. And at the end of 2 years, it was like this for me. I mean, I did not want to stay anymore in the country, because I said to myself, I don't want to work anymore. I literally lost every interest in working because I had already lost that interest about 3 years before. But now, after working 2 years as a contractor, I literally lost interest to work. And at the same time, there was no clarity in my mind what I'm going to do next. Because at least if you lose interest to work, at least you will be a preacher. At least you'll preach the word of God. At least you go and minister to somebody. But even that is not coming to me. There's no clarity whatsoever. But I want to get away from that country. So eventually, although my family and my children, it was like, you know, they were not interested to leave. And I remember you also telling us that for the next 5 years, you need to be there. Don't leave the country for the next 5 years. But I said, another 3 more years, there's no way I'm going to stay anymore. And we made a decision to quit Bahrain in 1 month. In 1 month, we made a decision to quit. We packed up everything. We just gave it away to everybody. And we packed our bags and came. And I remember I was the only person who was the most, I would have thought that I was the only person who was the most unhappy man because I don't have any clarity. But my family was equally unhappy because they were leaving Bahrain. So you can imagine four, my daughter by then had already gone to the US, 4 unhappy people sitting on that flight coming to India with have no clarity of mind what to do next. So finally we landed in Pune. And of course, after 2-3 months after settling in, we got the children, the two of them settled down in their school. In the meantime, I started moving out and coming to Goa for the retreats. We started having the growth retreats. I came for the first growth retreat in the month of January. And after I attended that growth retreat, there was like, if it was on a scale of 1 to 10, 3 was done before, another 2 points, but still there was so much of fear. There was so much of depression. I would never show it to anybody because my family knew that even I was afraid to even drive a car. I was afraid to get into the lift myself. I was afraid to even stay in the house alone. So I was not completely set free. But the second growth retreat, which took place in the month of June, I remember the second growth retreat, which was on the, you know, the spirit.
Strong, how to grow the strong spirit.
How to grow in a strong spirit. So that retreat was the turning point of my life. That retreat, that second growth retreat, how to strengthen your spirit. So at the end of that second retreat, now it was like, if on a scale of 1 to 10, it was probably about 7 or 8.
Wow.
It was amazing. It was really an amazing change for me. That second retreat, that June retreat, where I actually stayed indoors there. And I remember you even called me up to share my testimony about what happened in my issue in Bahrain. So after that growth retreat in 2018, immediately later, we both of us went to Malaysia. Then we went off to the UK together. And then there was no looking back.
Brother, listen. God anoints you not to get blessed. That's where people go wrong.
Yeah.
God anoints you to be a blessing. So even though you had to study the word day and night, you would never come out of your depression. The only way to come out of your depression is the day you step out in faith to go and minister to somebody.
Yeah.
So once you start ministering to somebody and you see results, now you get into an addiction that you are no longer living your life for yourself. You always want to go and minister to somebody else. Now,
and more than that, brother, is the moment I began to minister to somebody else and began to hear the problems of other people whom the Lord would lead me to, I would find my situation is so insignificant, so small compared to people who don't have a job, people who don't have anything, people who have been going through so much of depression for years on end. So relatively, I would say, Lord, I'm much better off. I mean, why should I? And so that desire within to go out and be a blessing to somebody did not come because it was my desire, but I think the Lord allowed that thing to happen so that he could make my issue absolutely, you know, insignificant compared to what I was facing.
That is what is very important is, you know, I am always looking for people who can go and reach out. But the issue is, if the person doesn't have the truth and the person goes and ministers to a congregation without a truth, not only the person who is preaching has destroyed himself, but he has destroyed the congregation as well.
True, absolutely.
And that is why it is very, very important that when you're ministering to somebody, you should be absolutely sure that what you are sharing is the right thing. Otherwise, you'll end up destroying people's life by the wrong preaching. Now, there are so many counselors who keep saying, I see some demon, I see some curse, I see this, I see that. Now, the one who is in depression, the little life was there, that also is gone because of the wrong counseling. Praise God.
Praise God.
And what about you, Melanie?
I don't know from where he started, brother, but it was a journey for me because, as I told you initially, I was not strong in the word, that strong in the word. But as I saw him, you know, just crumbling in front of my eyes, you know, Vincent was always such a strong person.
Because him talking without the fingers and all moving is like something is wrong. Because if he's standing like this and talking, that's not my brother. My brother has to have that, you know, the more than the words, no, is hand should talk. Then I know that my brother is all right. If his hands are not moving, and I told you also, I don't see his hands moving. The day I see his hands moving, I know he's on the right. The points are 10 out of 10.
Brother, but you know what? Every time you, in those days, you know, I think you came to Bahrain once or twice, even during that time. But even when he would, you know, have a slight indication of, you know, moving his hands or coming to his old expressions, you would always tell me, look, he's already back to normal. He's already back to normal. And I would just think to myself, you know, this brother has got so much of faith. I mean, he's not able to see. He's just looking beyond, you know, and that's that the scripture that, you know, don't see the things from the carnal point of view, but see the things at the end.
We do not look at things seen, but we look at things that are not seen.
Unseen. And I just understand.
Even that morning, that morning, when I was planning to take him from Goa, suddenly, I told you, please don't make a police complaint or anything, because I'm going to take him, because I cannot see him in this state. And he is actually sinking. If I don't take him now, I can see him sinking. And my brother just said, agreed instantly. Come on, let's go.
That was, I think, one good thing that, you know, he would always follow the instructions, brother.
Oh, so, yeah.
Even when we used to call you up like at odd times in the night and you would give us one scripture and, you know, he would always follow the instructions. And as a family also, whatever scripture you would give, I would write it in capital letters. And as you were driving in the car, we would all say the scriptures along with the children. So that was the only thing that we could hold on to at that time, brother.
You know, Melanie, at that time, we had two battles. He was also going through a battle. I was going through a battle which nobody knew. And I had to explain to him the battle that I was going through. Okay, only he knows the battle that I was going through. Nobody knew. And I said, brother, tell me, do you think my battle is small? He said, no. But at the same time, if we don't fire and build up our faith muscles, we are anyway going to be crumpled. You remember? And then we would walk all around the building and on the marching. And we would go on speaking the scriptures after scriptures, everything. It was one of the best time. And whenever I used to come to Bahrain, I would say, brother, I want your sandwich. I was crazy of Brother Vincent sandwich. Okay, from the time he has come to Pune, I have not come there. But I always remember the day I came to your house, I will be asking only one thing. Brother, I want your sandwich, even in Bahrain. So all those things which were there, no, we began to use those small things. And we began to encourage. We began to cook together. It was fun.
Praise God.
And only when he was about to take the flight, you know, when he's sharing his testimony, he doesn't know, but the kind of connections which we were having, you were asking, has he taken the flight? I would call you, sister, has he taken then in Bombay to see that this fellow doesn't come out if he comes up? Because he had to change the airport, you see, from the domestic, he had to go to the international. The friends were kept. That once he comes out, push him inside. Once he goes inside, he cannot come out. Praise God. And thank God that the whole family had received the word before the battle began. And today, as you say, let me repeat about the wiper. You know, many people will be saying, what is this wiper? The wiper is when a person, driver is driving a car and the rain comes, the wiper cleans only one surface. But the wiper, because it's continuous, it keeps on wiping the water. In the same way, person in depression, the thoughts are running at a high speed and you are got a wiper, you open your mouth and keep on speaking. So it is cleaning up the thoughts and you can keep driving your car.
Praise God.
Yes, Sister Goen.
Yeah, so brother, so that was the, as I told, the only thing that, you know, helped me to be strong and was clinging to the word. So what I started doing is, I think at that time you had these MP3 talks and, you didn't have YouTube and all of that in those days. So it had just started, I think. But I used to take the MP3 talks and they were all on my phone. And as I was picking up the children and coming, even waiting for them outside their school or in their tuitions, I would just plug it into my ears and keep feeding my spirit with those talks, brother, the MP3 talks on my phone. So that was the only thing, because I could see there were so many people who were going through, you know, different kinds of situations. And as he said, that my situation didn't look as big as what people were going through. And it built up my confidence, it built up my faith, because of course, Romans 10:17 says, faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. So as I kept on reading or, you know, hearing all those talks, my confidence started slowly. At the same time, we were also always confessing the word. So whenever I took the children in the car, we kept saying it on the rosary, the spirit of the Lord is upon dad, my God himself has anointed dad, filled him with his love and set him free. So we kept on saying the word for Vincent. But I used to have my own battles, brother. I remember calling you at different times because there were some times that I just couldn't take it, because, you know, the enemy would just keep telling me that, you know, your situation is hopeless. This man is never going to come out of it. And, you know, everything is finished. And I used to just look at him. I said, where is Vincent gone? You know, even like to get him get a smile out of him, you know, it was so difficult. And, you know, it seemed so, so hopeless. But it was only the word that continuously, you know, every time I kept reminding me of the word that was, the Lord kept saying, you know, do not fear, I am with you. I have a good plan for you. And there was this time, I was literally crying at one of the masses, and the Lord, you know, spoke to me and said, whatever you are experiencing is just temporary. There is something unimaginable that is going to happen in your life. And at that time, I really didn't understand. I didn't understand what it meant and what it was. But it was only years later, after we came to India, and then I was reading the word and I came across Ephesians 3:20 that says, you know,
God is able to do exceedingly
abundantly. God is able to do exceedingly abundantly, far more than you can ever ask or imagine. And when I see
through the power working within you.
Through the power, yes, I forgot. Through the power working within you. So as I see him now, and as you know, how God has made something so beautiful and so unimaginable in our life, I only know that it's only through his amazing grace. And another thing I wanted to share, brother, is that if at that time, you know, even if before Vincent's depression or any time before that, if he had ever told me that, you know, he was going to go full time into ministry and all, I would not have been able to take it. But today, when I see it, you know, God trained me and, you know, he gave me that kind of training all along, so that when he literally had to take that step and decide to go full time into ministry, I was just like, yes, you know, I just said, I,
there
was,
because you went through the fire yourself.
Yeah. So I was,
how do you understand why Janice sends me?
Yeah.
Only a person who has gone through the fire, only a person who has seen a husband go right into the pit and everything is saying the game is over. And the Lord brought your husband out, and you know, you have seen fire so close. You have seen chaos so close, the storm so close. And from there, when the Lord has brought you out and where you are now, you'll say, Lord, I will never, ever interfere in your affairs. He is all yours. A person who has gone, because a person cannot understand, why is this man running so much? Why is this wife giving him permission to go? Now, I want to ask you, would you give him permission to go to UK for a month?
Yes, please.
No, not now. in those days?
No, no. In those days, in fact,
in those days, yeah, you were like a fevicol stuck to him.
I used to often think, because that I think that desire was always in his heart. So sometimes he used to tell me, you know, what is it working and all, and I, what is the use of working? So I used to always think, oh Lord, this man will one day leave me with the three children and he'll go and he'll, you know. But today when he does, he's going and he's traveling, it doesn't bother me anymore, but brother, because, you know, I know that
he's... prepare you as well.
Yeah, praise God.
Hey, Brother Vincent.
Yes, brother.
And when we were staying in Kasmiro's house, you know, I hope he's not listening. When we were staying in Kasmiro's house, you know, the temperature outside is 2 degrees and all. And I used to tell him, hey, Brother Vincent, see, the heaters are on. You should always live against the season.
Yes.
When the season is this, you should live without opposite to the season. He said, what do you do? I said, listen, we close the door and we keep the windows open.
And put up the heater.
Okay. And the temperature inside is now 4 degrees, 5 degrees inside. Okay. Outside, everything is there. The heater is closed. The windows are open. And I said, now let's face it. Let's bear it. The body is saying, no, I want warm. And you're saying, no, we will stay in this temperature and still be comfortable. In the beginning, he would have said, this man is crazy. But now, as he began to do that, he said, that's how we build ourselves up for any season.
And brother, we used to come outside in the morning for breakfast in our shorts and in our t-shirts, whereas this one, Kasmiro and what's her name?
Bell
would come with all their warm clothes. And they used to wonder why these guys are absolutely in shorts, because they have faced the cold whole night.
So it was so beautiful. And when I met your sister at the airport, my God, like your mother, man, how many warm clothing? And after all that warm clothing, you know, we see a big jacket going from here till the down leg.
Brother, you don't spare any opportunity to pull my legs. I know you want to talk about that only.
And I said, is she your sister, your mother, man? But all these tough tools have really helped us. Isn't that true, brother?
Praise God, brother. Praise God.
The more you make yourself comfortable, you will be ending up in uncomfort. The more you go out of your comfort zone to comfort others, it makes a big difference. Yeah.
You know, brother, I was just sharing it, Melanie. And then whenever I share the word these days, I always get this thought coming that... you know, I worked in the corporate world for 32 years. And, you know, when I'm doing right now for the last almost now 3 years, I've been full time. I just began to realize that I would not even trade even the highest position in the world for what I'm doing right now, because there is nothing that can ever be given by this world or by anybody for what I'm doing right now. The joy. And, you know, the fact that, you know, you are right in the center of God's will, that you are really, you know, really it's the Holy Spirit who's leading you. The joy. I mean, I remember the days when I used to be working, I would sleep for about 8-9 hours. Now, sometimes I'm sleeping like I sleep by around sometime 1-2 in the morning and I'm up by around 6-6:30, 3-4 hours. But there is absolutely no sleep. There is so much of joy. It's no more the physical. We are on a different, our batteries are charged from the spiritual side, not physical batteries anymore. And the joy and the peace. And in spite of this pandemic or this lockdown, whatever you want to call it, it seems doesn't seem to bother me in the least. And praise God, everybody is in high spirits. And sometimes it seems like 24 hours are less for us because time just flies. And God is so good.
Gone crazy in him, Melanie? How can he say he's sleeping for 2 or 3 hours?
Abhi nahi bolega, abhi nahi bolega. Wo pehla bolta tha, abhi nahi bolega.
As long as he's crazy for the Lord, brother, that's fine.
Now do you understand? The day you taste and see how good the Lord is,
amen.
Nothing in this world can give you that joy. Now the greatest joy for me is to explore Africa. And I know what is waiting for me in Africa is extreme hardships, extreme uncomfort. But the Lord is preparing me for Africa, and I'm going to put big trawlers there. In every mission, thousands and thousands. By the time I finished 1 year, at least 1 million in Africa.
Praise God.
So I'm launching into deep sea, and once you get the taste of it, you are saying, Lord, I don't want any comfort. I don't want to do anything. I want to just be here, Lord, and enjoy this time with you to see Jesus in action.
Amen.
If you really want to see Holy Spirit in action, go to the poorest of the poor.
Praise God.
There the Holy Spirit is working overtime. He is only waiting for somebody who can come and stand there and preach the gospel and bang, bang, bang.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Lord. Thank you, Jesus. So just put your number there. And we would like people to call on, whoever wants to call this brother, this sister, both of them are available. Melanie, are you available?
Yes, brother. Sure.
So quickly. Yeah, give us your number. You can put in your ID. You go to your profile and put both the numbers.
I'm typing it on the chat, brother.
Okay, you tap it on the chat. Okay, type it on the chat. Thank you, Jesus. So Vincent number is +91 721 863 0241. +91 721 863 0241. And Melanie is +91 832 944 3919. I repeat again, 91 832 944 3919. So any woman who wants to talk, have a woman's talk. She is always available. And I know one thing, that every counseling she will give will be on the word of God. Vincent is already preaching, but she is also rooted in the word. And if you want her on Zoom to give a talk, everywhere they are available, praise God. Now they can go on air any part of the world.
Praise God.
No immigration, no visa, nothing at all.
Amen.
So I want you to make a prayer before we wind up.
Brother, we wanted you to make a prayer for us because we celebrate tomorrow 25 years together.
That I'm going to make.
And of course, we also would like to thank the Lord that our eldest has just graduated.
Wow.
She just graduated with a gold medal from the university 2 days ago.
Wow.
And that's a great news for us. Our perfect gift for us for our 25th year.
You know, brother, it's not only the gold medal, but what is very important is that your children are rooted in the word.
Yes.
You can have a gold medal with all the world system.
No, I'm said it about gold medal, brother, because
I'm telling gold medal is excellent.
I'm not so proud about that gold medal, because I even told my daughter, I said, you know, these medals and these degrees as compared to what we have with the Lord are really nothing to be compared. But what I wanted to share, why I said this, was because we have always been with the word. I think one sister shared earlier about the nurse. And as long as, you know, they have been in the word, Isaiah 11:2 is like, you can wake them up in the middle of the night and tell them about Isaiah 11:2. They learned it when they were so small, that the spirit of wisdom, knowledge, understanding, counsel, might, the fear of the Lord. And of course, 1 Corinthians 2:16, the mind of Christ. So they have been confessing that all the time. And I want to give the Lord the glory. The gold medal is only to prove how true the word is. How true the word is. That's the reason.
Praise God.
Praise Jesus.
So I want you to pray for the congregation, then we will pray for you.
Loving Father, I want to thank you for this wonderful opportunity that you have given both my wife Melanie and myself to share our testimony to all our brothers and sisters. To you be the glory, Lord, every moment. Lord, your word says that you chose us even before we were formed in our mother's womb. You called us even before our names were even known on this planet Earth. You chose us from the foundations of the earth, Lord, in Christ Jesus. And at this very moment, Lord, I want to thank you. Thank you for being such an awesome God, a God of love, a God of mercy, a God of compassion, a God of faithfulness. Lord, I want to thank you in a very special way for the gift of faith, for the gift of your son, Jesus. I want to thank you, Lord, for this privilege that you have given me and my wife and my family to be instruments in your kingdom. No matter, Lord, who it is, that we can share your word, we can share your truth with boldness, we can share our own testimonies of what you have done. Lord, it's no more theory, it's no more, Lord, something that in the Bible pages, but it is really a life that has been lived with the word and shown us your victory through the word that you have taught us through the power of the Holy Spirit. At this very moment, Lord, I just bless every brother and sister of mine who's listening right now. I thank you in a very special way for Brother Johnson, whom you have used mightily, Lord, to touch so many lives. And Lord, I know that I have been touched by the word through his preaching, through the word that you have allowed him to share. And Father God, I pray at this very moment that all my brothers and sisters who are listening right now on this chat, on the Zoom, on the YouTube, and where this video will go, that Lord, they too will listen to this word, that this word, this living word, that they will experience not only on paper, not because of the testimonies of others, but that they will personally experience it and the power of it in their own lives. And they will be able to share their own personal testimonies, testifying to your goodness. In a very special way, I want to thank you, Lord, for my wife, Melanie, for joining us together, for making us partners in your kingdom, so that, Lord, through us, we can reach out to all those who are lost, all those who are still struggling in their faith, that we can share our own lives, knowing, Lord, how faithful you have been to lift us up from the pit and to bring us, Lord, to the pulpit. I want to thank you, Lord, for giving us this opportunity, for being a faithful God, for allowing us, Lord, to be usable in your kingdom and to bring glory to your name. I want to thank you, Lord, for our children, Caroline, Shana, and Aaron, and for every member of our family right now, not only those who are with us, but even those who are listening right now to your word, that, Lord, together, we will make a difference in our own generation. These times, Lord, when we find there is so much of fear around, we will be instruments of your love, we'll be instruments of faith, we'll be instruments of encouragement to a world that is right now needing encouragement, requiring faith, and requiring to put away fears and see your glory. We thank you and praise you, Father, for all this. In the glorious name of Jesus, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Helen, you want to add something? Go ahead, add something. Come on.
I would also make a prayer for all those wives who are struggling as they see their husbands going through depression. Father God, I want to pray for all those wives, not only wives, but also family members who see their family members or their husbands going through depression. Lord, the same anointing that set me free, that gave me the strength through the word, through the power of your word, to cope up with my battle, that same anointing, Lord, I release on all these people who are going through their own battles, watching their loved one in depression. Lord, I pray that they too may get the truth of your word, the word that set me free, the word that gave me that strength and courage, that same word, Lord, may be given to them through the preaching of your word, and give them too that strength, that courage to fight their battle. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
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 Father, as they are celebrating their Jubilee tomorrow, What a great time, oh Lord. Two different people with two different atmosphere, two different history, geography, biology, physics, bringing everything into a new nest, colliding with each other, discovering each other, and turning into diamond in these 25 years. As the coal goes through the fire, the pressure and the temperature and the time, in the same way, you fuse them together with that perfect vow. And in this perfect vow, Lord, both of them began to discover. And this discovery was that when one is in depression, the other one is pumping in agape love, faith, to get the other person out of depression. And all these pressures of life in this 25 years has helped them to discover in the midst of trials how each one can become better in their own field. And Father, in this fusion of marriage that you have brought them together and they build their nest, you are more interested in the children in the nest. And that is why the marriage institution. And thank you, Lord, that the children have been fed with the spiritual food, not only with milk, but with solid food, because they themselves have been in the trials and they themselves have seen how faith has built their whole family. Father, I thank you for this nest that is anointed. Even when the mother eagle stirs up the nest, in the same way 3 years back, the nest was stirred only to bring a transformation. Like Moses saw the burning bush and he was filled with fear of Pharaoh. But that burning bush anointing took him back to Pharaoh to deliver his people. In the same way, Lord, I thank you that you took them after getting married to Bahrain, where they were living in a desert. And when the time had come, you brought them back to India, stirred up their nest, anointed them with a burning bush fire, that now discovering this fire and this anointing, Lord, their journey of their married life has just begun. A ministry that has been born now, especially right from the time of their marriage, they had got an anointing of couples for Christ. Lord, this did not happen by chance. This was your plan, your purpose. Today, they might not be in any title of any ministry, but they are in the title of you, Lord. The identity is not a ministry, the identity is you. And I pray, Father, with all the experience that they themselves went through, especially in their marriage life, where Satan is destroying marriage, Lord, let this couple be specially anointed for married couples, that the truth that they give will bring healing in marriages which are on the verge of divorce and separation. Thank you, Lord, that in all these years, they have discovered that their life has taken through the storm, and the key is the understanding of the Word of God. And let this truth that they have received grow more and more abundantly to be shared with not only the couples, but every person that they come across. And in the name of Jesus, as the daughter got a gold medal in the university, Lord, we bless the children with the gold medal of the university of the Holy Spirit. Amen. That these children are educated in the university of the Holy Spirit, where they have got the taste of the Lord. They have got the taste of the Word. They have got the taste of the anointing. That in every aspect of life, wherever this family is, Lord, you are glorified, Father, because the fruit that they bear is never of this world, but of your heavenly kingdom. Jesus. This Jubilee is just a beginning of a long, healthy, anointed, spirit-filled, demon-casting, sickness-killing, destroying, building up people, nothing broken, nothing missing, highly favored, prosperous, enduring life in abundance in their life. We seal this whole marriage, the whole family, the whole generation with your holy blood, Lord, from generation to generation. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, brother.
Thank you, brother, so much. Thank you, brothers and sisters.
And congratulations for tomorrow.
Thank you. Thank you, Sister Natasha.
God bless.
You want to ask them anything, Natasha?
Brother, when we hear them, we are not at all surprised with the things that are happening to them. So it becomes very difficult for us to ask them questions.
Teresa?
Marina.
I think she went.
Just want to congratulate.
They're starting at 2:30.
Oh, they have gone for this thing.
Yeah, brother, even we'll need to move because we have to log in into another ID right now.
Okay.
For praying in tongues.
God bless you all.
Thank you, brother. Thank you.
God bless.
So please, my brother is available in whichever country. He is ready to go to any country, anywhere. The wife has already given permission. Praise God. Hallelujah. And the wife is also ready to be there for preaching. Praise God.
Praise God.
God bless you all.
Brother, maybe she will travel with me as well. Who knows?
Surely. But what happens is, brother, our schedule is not in one place, you see. Our schedules are long hours and traveling. When you came with me to UK, brother, that's a very small schedule. Otherwise, the schedule is, very difficult schedule. For example, when we are in UK, my brother used to worry, now, how are we going to go here and there? And we used to have some argument in the beginning. And I would tell him, listen. That's God's job to decide how to take us. You don't decide. You just hold your peace and be quiet. And when the time comes, everything will be done. So he is an organized person because he was working in a corporate world. And I am a person who was a businessman. So two people going together, there would be friction. And I would say, watch and see. And every time, is that right, brother?
Yes,
supernaturally.
Brother.
And I said, brother, if you depend on the Holy Spirit, you will have a restless life. A total rest life. Otherwise, you will be totally restless. But as the days went by, he also began to realize, and it's the same, right?
Praise God, brother.
Praise God.
Because, our schedule is not like normal schedule. If it is morning this side, then by afternoon, we are going somewhere far, reaching there, and by the time we are reaching, we are also calling them, just start the praise and worship, we are reaching there. Is that right, brother Vincent?
Yes, brother, I agree.
And when you see, you are okay when you take your wife along. I'm not discouraging you. I pray that you take her in such a way where there are retreats, where the itinerary is one place, then it's okay. But if you are like a gypsy traveling from place to place, she will be burnt out.
Yes, brother. I agree, brother. I have to get trained first. I have to build up my muscles.
No. See, please understand. Each one is made different for a different purpose. All fingers are not the same. Now, when I traveled from Africa, I traveled on Sunday evening and I reached on Thursday morning traveling to Sydney. Now, if I take my wife, she say, you've gone crazy. Looking at the itinerary, she'll say, I don't want to come with you. See, each one is different. Hello?
Yes, brother. Yes, sir.
So I pray, listen to my prayer. I pray in the name of Jesus that you too will have powerful conferences on marriage where people come and stay in one place for 4 days, 5 days, 6 days, and you preach from the word the truth, and marriages are just healed, clicked, corrections are made, repentance are made by the truth that you share with the word foundation, and bang, you will have another ministry, both of you together.
Amen. Amen.
Praise God. Praise God.
That's why that I heard for the first time that you got after marriage in 1 year, you all joined the Couples for Christ. So why do you think God put you there? God put you there for a purpose. If the word is absent over there, you got the word now. You got the community now. You got the whole mixer now. Might be you don't have a title. Who wants the title? Because the birth of a baby in the nest is God's work. Praise God.
Praise God.
And I want to tell you, in the 25th Silver Jubilee, there's a baby in your womb, sister.
Amen.
The baby of a ministry for married couples.
Praise God. Praise God.
Praise God. Praise so God. Congratulations for this baby.
Thank you, Jesus.
And I can even see Jesus. The baby is already kicking.
Thank you, Jesus.
Does the baby kick? Melanie?
Yes, brother. Praise Jesus.
And you never know when the water bag will burst. Amen. And with this coming on Zoom, I want to tell you, somebody somewhere is listening on the YouTube or on the Zoom, and God is connecting people to get you on the track. And that's all. You know, the beautiful part of the kingdom of God is you don't know where he's going to take you, but he has got all his men, all his people set already.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Now, Brother Vincent.
Yes, brother.
One day you send me a message saying, brother, can you just do this for me? I'm going to UK. You remember?
Yes. Yes, brother.
And I turned around and I said, no. Brother, you got the numbers. Talk to the Lord and he will fix up the schedule for you. And when he fixes up the schedule, you will know it is the hand of God. It must have been difficult. But once you get the taste of it, now you're not relying on anybody. You are relying on God.
Praise God. Praise
Did your schedule get fixed up?
Fully got
fixed. It not only got fixed up, you had to do some extension.
Yes, very true.
Whenever you are going to rely on the Holy Spirit, there's always going to be extension. Whenever you are going to depend on the flesh, you'll be still struggling even after years. It is better to depend on the Holy Spirit than depending on anybody.
Brother, we were supposed to be in the US for our daughter's graduation, but lockdown did not allow. So when I went to the US, I thought Canada is close by. So I asked for Canada. So Canada opened up, but I could not go there. So the Archbishop of Toronto. So I got almost 4 places to share the word in Toronto. But praise God, it's only because of the lockdown. But you know, eventually there will be opportunities there. So we got our visas in for the US. We got our visa for Canada, but we're just waiting when the lockdown will end to go ahead and.
So that's what I'm saying. When you see, of the whole of Ireland, I met a man named Amal. Okay. He had come for his healing. 7 years later on, he calls me because his father started a small Bible class and he wanted somebody to water the plants. But he did not want somebody to come who is going to teach something opposite to what his father preached, because his father is already in the ministry. So when somebody comes and preaches something else of the foundation that is laid, he is only going to cause damage to the plants. Because then the plants are not knowing which one is the right one, which one is the wrong one. So he said, brother, I only want to stick to what the truth is. So he called me. So from the time he called me, he himself began to learn. And whenever he wants to teach something, he will say, brother, what do you think? Is this understanding what I'm understanding? Is it right or wrong? Because when it contradicts, it causes damage in the kingdom of God.
True, very true, brother.
It causes destruction in the kingdom of God. Okay, and so many people now who are walking in faith have got deceived to walk in unbelief, and it destroys people. And that's why the preaching is such a dangerous, that if a person is preaching something wrong, he has destroyed so many people's future forever.
Very true, very true.
Amen.
And the best part is, see, when I planted a wrong seed in people's life, God says, what you sowed, you are also going to reap.
Absolutely.
And that's why preaching is not an easy job. If you're not sure, don't preach that topic. Preach something that you know, and you know is the truth. Otherwise, you will destroy your life, your generation.
Praise God. Praise God.
Praise God. That's why I'm very, very cautious about what I'm teaching. And every teaching, I will see to it that it is backed up with the word of God.
Scripture. Yes.
Praise God.
Praise God.
Praise God.
God bless you.